Assalamu alaikum, everybody. Thank you for joining us again. In the comment section, if you can let us know if you've attended last session or not, just so that we have a sense. We will be doing a bit of a review for those of you who are joining us for the first time, but it would be nice to know who's been here before. My name is Jillery Massa. I am a equity education educator on racism, prejudice, and human rights. It's my pleasure to be here with you. I'm also part of the community, grew up in the community, and have lots of things to say about being Black and Muslim within the Muslim community. To begin, I always like to start all of our sessions with a land acknowledgement. And so we can never work to end systemic and institutional violence if we don't center the narratives of Indigenous people in our collective decision-making for social justice and equity. As settlers in Turtle Island, which is also known as Canada, we directly benefit from the colonization and genocide of the Indigenous people of this land. In order to engage in resistance and solidarity against injustices inflicted on the Indigenous people, it is imperative we constantly engage in acts of decolonization. It is important to acknowledge that we are in the Dish with One Spoon territory. The Dish with One Spoon is a treaty between the Anishinaabe, the Mississauga, the Haudenosaunee, and the Haudenosaunee that bound.
Be that many of us are not having this conversation because of, stances like this, right? And in some circles, we would call it spiritual bypassing. So sometimes we use spirituality to only focus on the fact how all of us are one and there shouldn't be any differences. And reality is that that's not how the system has been set up, right? So, and again, to remind ourselves that people who have suffered oppression, Black families in particular, they don't have this privilege. And it is a privilege actually to be able to focus only on the positive. It's a very hard stance to take when you are dealing with oppression every day. And when you send your children out in the world and you don't know if they're gonna come back home safe, right? It's a hard stance to maintain that kind of positivity. So we talked about some of the reasons why we're not having these conversations, and we really also discussed why we need to start having these discussions immediately, before we're ready. So sometimes we think that we don't know enough, and once I find out enough myself, I have to educate myself, that's when I'll start talking about it. And the point is that there won't be a time, because this is really a learning game, right? And by having those conversations, by allowing the children to ask the difficult questions, that's how we will grow in ourselves, in our own understanding. Because again, the best way to learn something is to talk about it, right? To have a discussion, to be open to questions. And when Jillery talked about the first slide, what really came up for me is defensiveness. What really stops us is when we are questioned and when we don't know the answer, or when we're caught, when we're called out doing something that is, perpetuating the system, it's very easy to get defensive. And, that's something that really blocks growth. Because the start of all wisdom is humility, right? So to know that we don't know, to accept, to acknowledge that we have been doing many things wrong, and to at least start the discussion, to start the learning. So let's see what's the next slide.
I guess, so as another reminder of what the conversation that we had last week was really about having people think and dig deep where they hold privilege in society. I think often as members of marginalized communities or repressed communities, particularly when we're talking about Islamophobia, we focus on the areas of our life where we do not hold privilege. And I think that it's important as a reminder to think about, when it comes to language and class and gender and ability and race, where you stand. How close are you in terms of the proximity to whiteness as we talk about it? So last week we chatted about those identities that are privileged in the society, male, white, able-bodied, straight, usually wealthy, connected, don't speak English with an accent, university educated. So where are the places that you fall? Where do you have privilege and where do you not have privilege? And I think that this is an important starting point in having this conversation. In the previous slide, as Marcia said, sometimes it is about not knowing. You're not having the conversation because you feel like you have to have all of the answers. But really, I think that a wonderful place to start is to evaluate where do I have influence and what in what domain do I have power, and how can I start there, right? Many of you have power within your families. That's a good place to start. In the mosque community, that's a good place to start. And really, I think what I've been reflecting on, Marzia, thinking about your conversation in terms of the defensiveness or the just really reflecting on where you've been positioned, I was on the other side in approaching this community and talking about this issue where, you know, I felt it was a write-off. Some of my friends told me, don't even bother. It's not worth it. And I've been humbled. I've been humbled by the response and the response that is connected to action. I think that sometimes we get stuck in kind of a circle of educating. Does this exist? Yes, it does. Does this exist? Yes, it does. And we're constantly just, you know, thinking that we need to educate the heck out of it instead of, you know, holding both education and action at the same time. And I think that the Jaffrey community has really taken it on a really uncomfortable conversation that sometimes is a challenging one to have in a really powerful way. And inshallah, it goes somewhere and somewhere meaningful. So I'll bring up this quote by Jiwan again, because I think that it's really important when it comes to thinking about identity. So it says, our identities matter, so humility is key. Who we are shapes the way we experience and understand the world and our relationships with others. Our identities are also complex and layered, and we are more than any one singular identity. In the society we live in, some parts of our identity are privileged, while others over others, and this shapes how we experience the world and often how we may choose to share or not. Parker Palmer reminds us, we teach who we are. When we sit, speak, listen to each other, our identities play a role. So as we listen, we must remember to think about who we are in relation to who is speaking. This will help us build a deeper understanding of each other. I think that this is a super important quote that encapsulates what I'm trying to say around the importance of being self-reflective in doing any kind of in parenting, self-reflecting in how we interact with our school communities, self-reflective in our leadership. Where are we positioned and how does that impact how we see the responses of others or how we see particular injustice? I'm thinking about the conversations that people are having about the response to the death of George Floyd or the murder of George Floyd, you know, whether the response is appropriate, whether the response is useful, the tactic of protests, the you know, some of the looting that's happening in some places, the call to defund the police. And we had a bit of a conversation about this last time, and I think, you know, it's really important as we frame our opinions around these things to ask yourself, where am I positioned? If I'm outside of the situation, perhaps I don't see the desperation that maybe somebody is taking on, right? So to adopt that sense of wonder of what has brought people to this point. Okay. So we're gonna, in the chat, I don't know if people are able to unmute themselves, and if not, that's fine. In the chat, we're gonna make some time for some conversation, and I hope that everybody cooperates and shares with us. I know that this is sometimes a bit of an unusual forum, but for those of you who were here last time, maybe you can share with us what your aha moment was, if you had one, or if you weren't here last time, have you had any aha moments about race? And the conversations about race that have been happening in the media. Another question to answer is, did you learn, what have you learned, or did you learn something that made you feel uncomfortable or angry or sad, and why? Can we unpack that or talk about that? And then also, is there something else that you'd like to learn? So we'll see the chat.
And maybe if they're answering the question, it would be good if you just put 1, 2, or 3 when you chat, let us know which question you're answering.
Take a moment to think about it. But what's going through your mind? Why are you back? What was that brought you back?
That's a great question. I think that for me, it was just knowing that what is going to be, what's the continuation? Like, how do I move the conversation forward? What mm-hmm. questions, how do I answer those questions?
Mm-hmm.
And I don't even know what those questions are. So to continue on the learning for something on a topic that's been there for forever, you know, as long as I can remember. And, you know, definitely if we can be able to, through our children, slowly put this fire out, it would be amazing. But just having the right tools, that's definitely what brought me back, along with the fact I had to do this. I took this responsibility, but of course, definitely gaining a lot of knowledge from this as well.
So we have 16 people on the line. Nobody has any thoughts on any of these three questions?
You know, in terms of the conversations happening on the media, and, you know, it's, for me, it's really been a process of becoming a lot more aware in how our unconscious mind has been shaped.
Yes.
And just becoming a lot more aware of language, of, you know, pictures, like even, you know, I mean, the picture that I used for this thing was, you know, it was some, and I know whenever I'm looking for pictures to use in a Muslim context, they also are full of shadism, right?
Yeah.
It's hard to find representative pictures. And so, yes, even language, for example, I know today, by the, like we all know, is Juneteenth, right?
Yes.
And I was talking to my daughter about it. And, you know, three times in the conversation, she caught me using language, which was, you know, which I had to rethink and reword.
Mm-hmm.
So it really goes deep. And again,
yeah.
The more you unearth, the, you know, the more you find, kind of thing.
Okay. Yeah, for sure. Yeah. For those of you who don't know what Juneteenth is, it's the today marks the day that slavery officially ended in the U.S. And I'm not sure actually what the date is for Canada, so that would be an interesting thing. So we have some chats in the comments. When this all happened, my son's class was doing an assignment about Imam Sadiq, and there was a question about race and discrimination, and my 9-year-old son had no idea what that meant, and he couldn't understand why people would be treated differently based on their color. Yeah. Another person said, Alia says, I don't think I'm able to unmute myself, but my answer to two is that what had made me the most uncomfortable is saying something or responding to elders when it came up. I'm glad I'm able to finally say something when it's wrong, no matter who said it. Balancing the notion of respecting elders versus standing up when you see or read something unjust. And this is in our tradition. Somebody will have to help me with the quote, but it's, you know, stand up against injustice, even if it's against yourself, right? So it's, you know, it's part of our tradition about how to do that and do it respectfully. Somebody else says, I was having a bit of difficulty of time explaining that people actually get treated differently based on race, religion, and culture, because I do not teach my kids to treat others differently based on their traits. I just wanted to share. Approaching anti-Black racism feels intimidating, especially in front of a Black audience. What are some tips for approaching this topic? This is my first time tuning in. What makes me uncomfortable is the notion that as brown, I have ascended on the necks of Blacks. I have benefited from being brown, and I'm questioning if I deserve my melanin. No, don't question it. We all deserve it. And I'm not sure if this was covered last week, but are you able to suggest exercises we could use that will help to identify if we have ingrained biases? Thank you for that. Any thoughts on those questions? And we have some, I mean, we can talk about some different activities that folks can use as takeaways, but those are some great contributions. Anything else, Marzia?
You know, the question about having a difficult time explaining that people actually get treated differently based on race, I think this is a very important question that will come up again, right?
Yes. Because
as we said last time, their moral compass is very finely tuned, and they pick up on these things way, you know, quick, like we have learned over the years to accept things, and children obviously bring a fresh perspective. So, you know, a great way to start any conversation is to reflect back, you know, what they're wondering, what is upsetting them, what they think about it. And, you know, two things, books are a really good place to start. And yes. I think we've already put a book list for talking about these things, like children's books, on the JSS Facebook page. And if we haven't, it will go up. So there is really great books available out there to start the conversation. And two, you know, appropriate news stories as well, right? So we've been posting a lot of stuff, by the way. So if you, you know, obviously we can't cover everything here, but if you just look at the Facebook page of Jaffrey Support Services, you would see a lot of additional resources to start the conversation.
Excellent.
Jerry, what would you say about this, approaching anti-Black racism feels intimidating?
I think it feels intimidating because it's a relatively new, it's not a new issue, but it's a new word that we've developed. And I don't think that you have to know everything to know how to talk about these things with your children, to understand that there are challenges in this world, and unfortunately, you know, our society is set up in a way that has said some people should have and some people should not. And I think, especially because we can lean on an Islamic context, we can give lots of examples to our children as to how Allah says the opposite. And so, you know, like I've been asking the adults around in my work, in my life, what system are we upholding, or, you know, what system are we thriving to uphold? The system of Allah, which says that we are made from nations of tribes to get to know one another. And even, you know, reading that quote with your children and asking them what you think, what they think it means. If there has been an example of where people haven't tried to get to know one another, that people have passed judgment instead, might be a useful way to approach it. But, you know, there's lots of resources if you want to know. And, you know, right now, particularly, there's lots of resources out there to learn more about anti-Black racism. I'm still learning myself. So if that's a way for you to, you know, tackle it. But I think it's important to also understand that in the same way for people to treat us as Muslims with dignity, they don't need to know every single verse of the Quran and every single aspect of Islam. I don't think that you need to know all of the ins and outs about how anti-Black racism operates to understand and to know, to teach your children that people should be honored regardless of their skin color.
And we have some more questions here. I'm not sure if this was covered last week, but are you able to suggest exercises we could use that will help us identify if we have ingrained biases?
I think an exercise that I like to do with myself even is that kind of association. So last week, I showed a video with this group of the peanut butter and jelly analogy. Did I show that group, that video? Where, you know, I say peanut butter and automatically we match it with jelly. Because for our entire life, at least in the Western context, that has been associated with peanut butter, right? So we can do the same thing with race. I say Chinese, what do you think? I say Muslim, what do you think? I say Black, what do you think? And you'll understand and know when the negative connotations come through. Right. And so then it's about unpacking those things and where are they coming from? What messages am I hearing that I'm internalizing and maybe imparting onto my children?
No, I actually found a wonderful test, an online test.
Oh, did you?
That I'm sure, because I have a bunch of lists, links, I have to go through it. Mm-hmm. It's really interesting because they did it several ways. They show you a word and then a picture. Mm-hmm. Flip it, and it was very interesting. Mm. And you know, you're supposed to do it quite quickly, so it's really good. I mean, that's exactly what it's designed to do, is to uncover your implicit biases. So if I can find it, I will also post that one on the Facebook page.
Okay, we're gonna move on, and we'll continue to answer the questions as the chat keeps going. But Sister Marzia.
So again, to remind ourselves that this is not one conversation. It is not something to tick off a box. It is, an ongoing thing, just like with everything else that we talk to our children about, right? And so there are many different kinds of conversation that we have in the race field. And of course, there is definitely, the conversation about anti-Black racism is the conversation about the history of discrimination, right, against specific group. We could put that in context with other broader conversations about our common humanity, and again going back to the Quran and using that as a reference. Alhamdulillah, we really are lucky to have such a strong statement that we can fall back on, right? That even a child can understand, and so can a grown-up, right? And we can just keep checking ourselves, is this what we're doing? Is this fulfilling the purpose of getting to know one another, or are we doing something else, right? And also conversations about having pride in our own racial or ethnic group. That's definitely one part of the conversation, because again, if we are to respect all cultures, and it is important for children to have some, and as Muslims and as also recipients of Islamophobia and all of that, that is an important conversation in having that, and following on from that, again, the conversation about anti-Black racism, it would be sad if it was just about the history of discrimination, right? We need to really acknowledge that a lot of learning and a lot of like the history of resilience, right? It's not only about discrimination, but it is about a nation that has survived and thrived despite all of this. So I think that's something that we need to bring up in our conversations. And lastly, a conversation that prepare children for discrimination. So chances are, and this I shared last week as well, that, I never ever thought that my kids would experience discrimination. I don't know why, but it just wasn't on my agenda. It wasn't on my radar. I thought, we live in a really great neighborhood. We have all sorts of privileges, right? We are positioned we never thought of ourselves as marginalized or anything. And yet, we have experienced this, right? So that is certainly one, one aspect of the conversation as well.
Yeah, and I would add that in that conversation about resilience, there's also lots of stories about how racialized communities and Black communities have contributed to, our Western history, but also the histories of our faith, the history of Islam. So even, bringing up the pride in that reference and pride in your own cultural heritage is an important place. I have a four-year-old. We're not talking about the death of George Floyd in my house right now. I don't know that I'd want to show her that video. She's too young. But we are talking about, why she has cousins that are all different colors, in one family, my brother-in-law's family, their son is white, because, my brother-in-law is Black, the wife is white. The son is white, the daughter is Black. So we're having lots of conversations about race and color and difference and all of those things, and how genetics are a very funny and beautiful thing. So, thinking about ways to talk about race with your children that don't always have to be the doomsday discrimination story, I think they'll lead you in that conversation in terms of when they're ready. Okay, so we're gonna watch these two videos. We'll start with this one over here. Let me know you can hear it.
Race is one of those touchy subjects you don't really wanna get into because you're afraid you might mess up. But the fact is that as early as 3 years old, children are classifying people based on their appearances. And so the worst conversation adults can have with kids about race is no conversation at all. Talking to kids about race needs to happen early, often, and honestly. Saying honestly, yeah, people are different, cultures are different, but that's a good thing. How boring would it be to have a crayon box that all had the same color? There are so many ways to approach racial conversations. You can use Dr. Seuss books. You can use any sort of pop culture reference. There are many, many movies, animated movies especially, that form a good entryway. So it's helpful, especially as a parent, to watch the movie beforehand maybe, or read a plot summary and say, well, what's happening here? Or look at all the other princesses. What do you notice about them? Do you think anyone can be a princess? Do they have to have a certain skin color or look a certain way? And it's usually good to sort of stop along the way, pause two or three times strategically, and bring up this conversation. Kids, just like adults, don't just respond to words. So this isn't just quote-unquote talking to your kids about race. This is actually experiential learning that we need to do. I remember taking a class to the Lorraine Motel where Dr. King was assassinated. And when young people see that, that impacts them. And then we can use that experience, that hands-on, visceral encounter with race and racism, to have a much more substantive conversation, and it feels different. And you can do that in your own local city. There are historical markers, those signs you pass all the time and never read. Stop and read them one day. See what they say. See what happened there. See if you recognize the names, or if you don't, go and look them up. Utilize all the resources around you and make sure that you're not just talking to your kids about race and diversity and justice, but you're showing them why it's important. Racism is detrimental to the entire society, no matter if you're black or white, Latino, Asian, Native, whomever. Everyone is impacted, and that's why we need to raise a generation of people that's going to turn around and try to change that momentum toward the tide of anti-racism and racial justice.
When you're saying you're afraid to talk to your child about race, it's not for them, it's because we are afraid. If we're being honest, we don't know how to talk about it and we're concerned. So what we encourage is to think about your competency rather than your content. So if you can think about what are some of the skills that I might want to develop with my child, which again might be inquiry, it's just a question. What did you notice? How did that make you feel? So if we can create skills based on inquiry, confidence because you practiced it more, maybe that means you practice with yourself in the mirror like you do when you go to your job interview or anything else. Maybe you practice it with your loved one. And again, you're unpacking for yourself first. So skills, confidence, and then stress. If you go into it without having spoken about it, without thinking about what it means for yourself, you're going to be highly stressed the entire time that you talk to your child. But if you can focus on what are the things that are within my control when I talk to my child, maybe I can't change the entire police system, but I can help my child to navigate that one specific thing that they have going on. What can I do today? So that'll reduce stress in that moment with, again, along with practice and with questions. So along the developmental age, you can use those same three strategies, skills, confidence, and stress. At 3, at 10, at 15, your child is never too young to have any discussion about it, but you don't want them to have the most stressful and the most strenuous conversations. But again, you're the expert, you're the parent, you already know what that is. It's time for you to take your fear away from your child being the best that they can be.
Okay, some conversation again. Maybe some just initial thoughts about those two videos. I know that it was a lot. I think about the first video where it talked about the going through your city and looking at different landmarks and having conversations and making it kind of an immersive conversation. And that actually reminds me of a thought, of a memory that I haven't thought about in a long time. I had shared before that, you know, I come from a Latin American household where we don't talk about our Blackness at all. we culturally are unfortunately, we've been so colonized that we're trying to remove ourselves from our African heritage as much as possible. We attach ourselves to the like drops of whiteness that we have, or European heritage that we have. But one of the first, when my mother converted to Islam, I was maybe 4 or 5 years old. And then when I was about 7, she remarried a Muslim, and he was Shia, but he had converted from Sunni Islam to Shia Islam. And before that, he had kind of left the religion for a while. And what brought him back, like many folks during that time, he's not Black, he's South African Indian, but many of the people that he hung out around were converts, and many of them were Black. And how many of them got introduced to Islam initially was through the Nation of Islam. That's a very common story. And I remember being around 7 or 8, and they had just gotten married, and Louis Farrakhan had come to town. And so although we were Shia and we were not followers of the Nation, we went to this talk. And I didn't understand what was going on, but I understood the feeling. And I think that was the first moment that I realized that I was Black. Because just, you know, the power of all of these Black Muslims in the space, and this person, you know, talking about justice. And at that time, I didn't fully understand all of that was saying. But, you know, we had conversations about that for a long time after, about what they were fighting for, about what, you know, what Islam had brought to this community. And although, you know, it wasn't a form of Islam that we practiced, you know, what it had really done for this community. So I think about kind of how impactful that situation was in my understanding of race at a young age, and even my understanding of how my family had historically kind of not talked about race. That's an example. And I think that there's lots of ways that, you know, you can expose young children to those experiences. In Toronto, hopefully after COVID is over and we're like are allowed to reunite again, they have something called the Freedom Train in the summertime, and they rent out the subway from Union Station, and they go to Kipling, I think, and they do a whole kind of Underground Railroad experience where they talk about the history of the Underground Railroad and the history of slavery in Canada, and you know, kind of an immersive situation that is really, really powerful. Okay, so conversation in the chat group, reflections on those videos, and then we have these 3 questions. What did the people that raised you teach you about race, directly or indirectly? What would you want to do differently? Where do your anxieties related to talking about race or racism come from? And when was the last time you experienced a shift in perspective regarding the topic of racism, and how did the shift occur for you? So we can spend maybe the next 10 minutes having that conversation, and I'll open up the chat.
Okay, so what would you want to do different? Where do your anxieties related to talking to your children about racism lie? Personally, I don't even know, like Marcy had said, I don't even think I ever really had much of a conversation around racism, especially to the way that it's happening now. But I think probably just making it clear that, making sure they got the right point, that it's not okay, that, and even like to how, like racism goes not to such a small, minute words that we think are like not a problem. So even down to those points would probably be something to really focus on and kind of take out of the conversation. Would probably be that area that I would be concerned about.
Yeah. I think my fear, and I mean, I definitely have fears, even though I think about this stuff all the time. My fear is exposing my young kids to things too early. And I think that's a common one that I hear. Mm-hmm. How do I approach this in a way that doesn't, you know, traumatize them unnecessarily? How do we have these conversations without like making them feel like it's this big thing that's coming to get them? Because I think for some of us, you know, we go through a lot of our lives without really experiencing those overt forms of racism. I definitely have very, like, often that the racism I experience is Islamophobic. It's not anti-Black. But yeah, I think that I I fear exposing them too young.
Mm-hmm. I have a comment here. Everyone is equal in front of Allah. Color does not matter. It's the inner self in being human.
Yes, agreed. That's absolutely true. Unfortunately, it doesn't play out that way in life. Mm-hmm. But yes, you know, that's what our faith teaches us.
I have another one here. I feel unless you have been a victim of racism, can you really understand what it is and how painful and fearful it can be? And you are better able to explain things to your kids. Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure I would agree with that, because I think, you know, a lot of learning we do, I mean, we haven't experienced history, we haven't experienced anything, you know, and yet we know that it's, you know, it instinctively feels wrong, and it is wrong based on values, it is wrong based on scripture, it is wrong based on many different levels, right? So I'm not sure if we need to experience it, and even really young children, you know, Jillery, going back to your point, mm-hmm. about traumatizing kids, I think, you know, if we start the conversation with fairness rather than racism,
yes,
we can get it really early on, right?
Yes,
and have a really inbuilt
idea of what's fair.
Yeah,
absolutely, you're correct.
You know, an answer to that.
And I think some children are just, you know, like when I look back, I think my youngest daughter, I mean, she was born an activist. She really was.
Mashallah.
When I think about the things that she did at the age of 4 and 5, she, you know, I mean, she stood up for things like as soon as she could speak. So yeah. And nobody, like, I don't remember having any different conversations with her than I did with my other kids, right? But there you go. So I think kids probably understand more than we give them credit for. And certainly, you know, books are a really good way to them to experience different worlds, which, you know, they are not part of, and, you know, they may not experience directly. But unfairness, I think everyone can, like being bullied or watching someone, you know, having power over somebody else.
Yes.
That's something that they can relate to.
Yeah, and I think that you're right on being the, like, not having ever been the victim of racism, not knowing how to feel that pain. I think if we apply that, also that logic around fairness, like, we know what's fair. And I think that when we see something that, it, at least I hope that when you see something that is not just, that it does something to your heart. So that's one piece. But I also think, you know, for many of us who have parents, maybe, you know, maybe some of you are like me, where I wasn't born here, but I basically, you know, I was 2 when I arrived to Canada. So this is all that I know. And so culturally, I feel more Canadian than anything. But for many of our parents, or maybe grandparents who immigrated here at a time that it wasn't so diverse, Toronto wasn't so diverse, the GTA wasn't so diverse, they were, you know, trying to make it, I'm sure that they have some stories of the things that they experience. And perhaps that's also an opportunity to have an intergenerational dialogue about those things, and for your children to learn a little bit about where their roots come from here. I know that my stepfather, for example, he came in the 70s with his parents from South Africa, fleeing apartheid South Africa. So we would have lots of conversations about apartheid growing up, because it was such a stark understanding of how white supremacy in its worst form operates. But, you know, he came fleeing from apartheid into a country that was free, but, you know, spent a lot of his high school years running from Nazi skinheads. You know, Nazis were a thing in Canada at that time, and he was one of the only brown boys in his school. And so, you know, he would tell us stories growing up about some of the things he experienced in the neighborhood that we grew up in, because we lived in the neighborhood that he grew up in. So some of the ways that we can have those intergenerational dialogues as well. Mm-hmm. Okay, some other comments here.
Yeah, I have a response to question number one. Did the people mm-hmm. that raised you teach you about race, directly or indirectly? And the response is, I was taught indirectly that lighter skin is prettier than darker skin. I still hear people say the word fair, often when describing someone positively. Makes me feel below.
Mm-hmm.
And I have another one here. I was born in Kenya and moved to Canada when I was 7. My parents showed me that there was no difference between us as Asians and the local Black community in Kenya through their actions. I feel blessed to have lived my foundation years in Kenya, as I feel that it has really made me stand up for racial injustice here in Canada.
Yeah, so two examples of how upbringing has influenced maybe how you're able to tackle these conversations, which highlights, I think, the importance of having these conversations with your young children, for sure. And also thinking about how to model, right? So now, if you, now that you have children, are you giving messages about who is fair and who is not, and what is beautiful and not what is not, subconsciously, because that's all you know.
Yeah, and sometimes we have to actually counteract the messages that they're being given from right? I mean, this has been a big thing. So people like from the subcontinent, shadism is huge, right? I mean, the definition of pretty is fair. And I'm not sure if I shared this last week, but somebody actually told me recently, like a few years ago, that they used to feel really bad for me when they saw me with my mom, because my mom is so fair. And they actually did. They said, we felt sorry for you because your mom.
Oh my gosh.
And that's, I mean, it was so ingrained that you don't even, like, I remember being told when I went for a shower that don't come out till your two shades light, right? Like, basically, scrub yourself till you get rid of the dirt.
Yeah.
And it was really hard to shield my girls from that because I mean, luckily for them, growing up, I mean, being in touch with them, that, you know, they didn't experience it because they just happened to be fair. I don't know how. Mm-hmm. My husband and I are really dark, right? But you know, they would be compared to their cousins or their peers who weren't, so of the lighter skin color. And I remember feeling really uncomfortable. Even though they were not the recipients of it, but just being in that environment where, you know, it's, and you have absolutely no control over it, right? You have no control over what you look like, what color skin you happen to be born with. And then, you know, yet people are continuously commenting on it. And I think the post-colonial mentality in the subcontinent is really strong. Like, you know, we've actually embodied everything that, we've taken on the standards of beauty from the colonizers, which is quite unfortunate.
And I mean, my experience is very similar. And I feel like the Latin community has also embodied colonization in a particular way. And growing up, you know, my sister and I are a year and a half apart, and we're like thick as thieves. We were always together. But she's lighter skinned. So they would call us la negra y la blanca, which means the white one and the black one. It's this is like just normal nickname. And you know, I don't how I internalize that or how we internalize that. But it's just interesting that it just becomes these nicknames that we get offered, or, you know, my father says, I'm the darkest version of white. I'm not black. I'm just the darkest version of white. So these kind of jokes that get thrown around.
So those are our questions.
Those are our comments.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, Sister Marzia.
So what specifically, you know, when we are having the conversation with our children, what are some of the things that we do need to take to talk about, right? I mean, it's great to have conversations generally about differences and diversity and all of that. But we do need to talk about privilege. You know, that's part of the conversation that is really important. It's really important to make it clear that it is unfair. And, you know, have some discussions about, again, how random it is that, you know, I remember growing up, my father would always tell me, you know, because in Pakistan, there were always, you know, there are beggars on the street. And when we were in the car, he would always say, never forget that you are sitting the fact that you're sitting inside and not outside is just, it's an accident of birth, right? I mean, you have not done anything to deserve that privilege. And similarly, you know, the randomness of the color of your skin, you know, it's really something really weird to be discriminating about, right? So it is important to have that conversation. And also just answering questions honestly and factually, right? Of course, according to the age of the child, but not not trying to cushion the truth. What do I mean by that? So, you know, why was George Floyd killed? You know, that might come up, you know, that, like, especially with elementary age and above. And just being very honest that it was, you know, it was not right. I mean, no matter, and, you know, sometimes you hear things on social media to look at the other side. And that's a really dangerous conversation to have, right? It's a really, it's tries to deflect from what's really important, right? And in no uncertain terms, we have to tell, we have to let the kids know that what is happening is unacceptable. Like, there's no excuse or justification, no matter what they see. I mean, if they read a justification, you know, why it's not, why it's not valid, right? So, Jillery, what would you want to add? Hello? I'm not sure if I'm frozen or...
Okay, can you hear me there? I was on mute there for a bit.
Okay. Yes.
Yeah, so great. Yeah, so it looks like we lost her. So we'll have to get her back.
I'm just going to send a message.
Sure, that sounds great. So while we are working on that, I'd like to get some feedback here from those who are participating. What are your thoughts so far that you've gotten from what you've heard? There's been some really amazing conversation going on here and points made with Marzia and Jillery, and we'd like to just hear what you have to say. How has it impacted you? How has it changed your thoughts towards anti-racism? Have you had this discussion at home if you were attending the first one? Were you able to share with your family or children? And what kind of responses did you get from them? We'd love to hear from you, just so we can gauge how things are moving along with you. Because I'm really actually appreciating this conversation very much. It's bringing up topics and conversations which we just kind of assumed, like, you're always in that thinking that we'll kind of, it's, so school will take care of it, someone else will take care of it. So just these points that are coming up with Marzia that she just mentioned is really important to grasp for us. Marzia, is there anything else you'd like to add?
The next thing we were going to be talking about is just reminders from parents, and we have been discussing this already. So just to wrap up the conversation, but I think there's another question.
Yeah, that's
more challenging with members who are older. They aren't willing to change as easily, and some of their ideas are ingrained in them too deep. Yeah. So I think Jillery's back. Salma, so you might have to promote her to co-host again.
Okay, I don't see her here though.
Yes, I see her.
Do you see her?
Promote to panelist.
Perfect. Okay, we can't hear you.
Can you hear us, Jerry? So just unmute yourself, please.
Yeah, we don't hear you.
Although it's saying she's unmuted.
Yeah, it's saying she's unmuted, but we don't hear her. No, put your volume up.
So while you do that, I'm going to start answering that question. So I'm able to have these discussions with my kids, but it is more challenging with members who are older. They aren't willing to change as easily. And this is definitely true in to some extent, in the sense that yes, children are just much easier. You know, they get it. They have less baggage. They have they don't have a history, right? For older people, it is more challenging. And again, you know, when two things we can do, right? Have start with the right intention. So if we have compassion in our hearts and we're doing it from a place of love, they are more likely to get it, number one. Number two, again, focusing on what's within our circle of control, right? If we think that the outcome is that we're only successful if you've actually been able to change someone, we're going to be really unhappy in life, because very often most of the time, we don't have control over how other people think, behave, or speak, right? What we do have control over is how we speak, and what we say, how we show up in the world. And as long as we are doing that, then people make decisions. And as long as we've spoken our truth, we have shared our experiences to the best of our knowledge, shared why it is important, to do this. This is, that is the best we can hope for. So does that help, or do you have any other comments on that? So Jillery is back.
I don't see her again now.
Because you have to look at the participants, and it's okay.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Amazing. Sorry, my son unplugged the modem.
Okay.
What timing?
We want your attention.
Yes. I'm hiding in our in the upstairs bedroom.
Yes.
Okay. I can go back to sharing the screen if you'd like. I just need somebody to give me the ability to do so.
You should have it.
Yeah, I got it now. Where were we? Sorry, folks.
That's okay. This is the nature of the digital.
Thank you,
okay.
For your patience.
Yes, here we are. So we were talking about this slide, and I heard you answering a question partially, Sister Marzia.
Yeah, so I was just talking about how with older, with people who are not children, like adults. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Can be more challenging for sure, because they're obviously they have more of a history, right? And mm-hmm. more ingrained beliefs. And what I said was that we can do what we can do. You know, we can have a good intention, we can have compassion and love in our hearts, and we can speak, with like responding rather than reacting.
Yeah.
All of those things we can do. And the outcome of that conversation is never in our hands. So as long as we focus on, on calling it out, on speaking up, that really is the best we can do.
Yes, absolutely. And I will tell you that I had a session with them, some of the uncles. It's called the Baraza group on Sundays afternoons. And I was like, also thinking, like perhaps they're not a group that will be open, but they invited me, so which I was surprised by. And honestly, they were very open-minded, I think struggling with some of the same challenges that all of us are struggling with, and how you know, oh my goodness, how have I been operating my whole life and having these moments, and holding on to some of their own kind of historical roots, you know, being displaced themselves in Africa and from Africa, and some of that, you know, the tensions that come out of that. But for the most part, we're really open-minded and progressive people, and thinking about, you know, my grandchildren are always calling me out on things, and so wanting to have, be involved in these conversations and be involved in the learning. And I again found it a really humbling experience, because I went in feeling like, you know, it's 70 plus is the medium age in this group. And here I am, you know, this young woman coming and telling them, you know, telling them what they, how they've been operating is wrong. And they took it with such grace, and they really honored it. And even afterwards, were sending me emails of articles that they found, and what do you think about this and that? And so maybe we have to give our elders a little bit more credit, that they have their own experiences. And I think, you know, for the most part, they are just God-fearing, loving people. And so I think if we start from that perspective, anybody can change an opinion. Anybody can change an opinion.
Bias goes in many different places, right? I mean, we sometimes we assume just because they're older,
yes,
that they will have this. And yes, at times it can be true, but not every single time, right? And we've seen this. I mean, we've seen our community grow in so many different ways, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, in the relationship sphere, for example, when we first started doing this work, only women would show up.
Yes.
You know, and now it's like 50-50, you know, yeah. People are so open to it. So yes, yeah. Sometimes it takes a while to change paradigms, and we just need to keep doing the work.
Mm-hmm.
And
I think that relationship between grandchild and grandparent is something really beautiful that opens up conversations that maybe child and parent can't have at when now they're adults and starting their own family. And so I've even seen, like, my grandfather just recently passed away, but with my youngest sister, they were very, very close. And the conversations that they would have about the world and where they are, you know, he's seen so much himself, and holds on to things and taught her a lot, and she taught him a lot. And I thought it was a very beautiful kind of exchange that they had, that he wasn't able to have with her father, his son. You know, because sometimes the parent-child dynamic is interesting, but the grandchildren, they do something. So perhaps, you know, I think it's try to have an intergenerational conversation about this. Grandpa, have you experienced racism before? You know, what was it like coming to Canada when you came? And go from there.
Yeah, and I think, you know, on that note, even as parents, we can learn so much from our kids. You know, being called out, like if we we put down our defensiveness and being open to learning and being open to look at our own biases and things, we can really, you know, go very far.
Yeah. Let's see what the next slide is.
Yeah, so this is just basically, summarizing things that we have talked about. Is there anything that you would like to highlight here?
No, I think the piece that you said about being ready to listen and learn, I think that we, you know, children bring such an innocence to the conversation, and you, like you've said many times, have a moral compass that's so clear, that being willing to like engage in the education work together, right? And I think in doing that, in even being able to say, you know, I don't know the answer to that. Maybe we can look at it together. First of all, in the eyes of your children, will humanize you, and will make it so that they do feel like they can come and talk to you about a variety of different things. And even when it's a difficult topic or you don't know, that you're willing to go and look and think about it together. And I think that we're in a unique time that there's so much media out there. There's so much alternative media out there, that there's lots of ways to engage in the conversation in ways that doesn't need to feel like confrontational or aggressive, or, you know, there's lots of ways that we can. I like that idea of watching a movie and pausing and asking questions. You know, my daughter's really into The Princess Story, which I hate, but even using it as a moment to talk about, you know, like what are the, what is it trying to say here? Who can be a princess? Can you be a princess? Why or why not? I think is encouraging. And I just go back to the pieces around like kind of the subtle messages that I hear that we share with our kids. And I think about, I have a friend who is a white passing Latina. Her husband is a African brother. They have a child who curly hair, is a black child. And my daughter looks more indigenous than she does black. And she has kind of longer straight hair, straight, bigger curls. And the comment from my friend when they come into the house is, oh, to her daughter, look at Iman's hair. It's so beautiful and it's so long. And I have to be like, please don't do this. Like you're sending a message to your daughter about what her hair is in comparison to mine, right? And for Black women in particular, the politics around hair is a very interesting one. And, you know, the longer your hair, the straighter your hair, the types of curls, all of that has something to say in a very similar way that we talk about shadism. So, you know, I'm just like appalled and have to, you know, tell my friend, you don't know what you're doing to this poor girl when you constantly comment about my daughter's hair. And I thank you for complimenting Iman, but you know, you're sending a message to your daughter. And so just thinking about kind of those passive ways that you might be sending messages to your children when you compliment something that looks different than them in a way that you don't compliment them.
Yeah. So, yeah, I think we've covered most of these.
We wanted to leave you with this quote and then open it up for further conversation. And I found it a really interesting take since, you know, 2020 feels like a decade. So much has happened already in this year, starting with, you know, the things that had taken place in Iran with the general and then the, you know, those members of our community that we lost in the plane crash. And then, you know, my husband would say Kobe Bryant died, and that was a, you know, big thing for him. And then all of the impacts of COVID-19, and now, you know, the conversations that we're having about race as a result of the police brutality. This is something that I've seen circling online, and it says, what if 2020 isn't canceled? What if 2020 is the year we've been waiting for? A year so uncomfortable, so painful, so scary, so raw, that it finally forces us to grow. A year that screams so loud, finally awakening us from our ignorant slumber. A year we finally accept the need for change, declare change, work for change, become the change. A year we finally band together instead of pushing each other further apart. 2020 isn't canceled, but rather the most important year of them all. And this is by Leslie Dwight. So we'll leave you with this and we'll stop sharing and, you know, spend the last little bit just answering any questions or having a bit of a conversation in the chat. Inshallah.
Those were the great way to end off this conversation. I have one comment here. The way we view ourselves, our own skin color, is a very important concept that can shape our views and our kids.
Yeah, absolutely. In the same way, you know, we talk about the body positivity movement for women who have girls, right? To think about how do you even see your own self-image if you don't, you know, look a particular way or uphold a standard of beauty that's pushed on us. I think the same thing has to do with race and religion, right? So how are we sending messages of pride about our skin color, about our faith, so that our children then embody those things? Absolutely.
I agree with that. And yeah, I've learned a lot again from all of this. Just waiting for some more comments and thoughts to come in while we do that. It's been a very, very educational two sessions we've had here. I think that information that's been given is really great, and I encourage everyone to share the information from our Facebook page, the Jockey Support Services page, Facebook page. We'll have our both webinars posted there. Please do inform your friends and family members, whoever, let them know to come have a look at it. And if you have anything else, please do send us your feedback to events at JS. Events jss@gmail.com.
And if we could perhaps just have takeaways, you know, what's the one thing that you're going to take away, perhaps do differently, think differently. Mm-hmm. That's really a good way to wrap up. So
I have one person who said thank you and I learned a lot.
So can you say one thing that you learned?
Yeah. Or one thing that you'll take away from the conversation.
So within our own communities, we see each other and our girls based on height and skin color, to the lighter, the better. Mm-hmm. How can we shift away?
I mean, I think you can start reframing that for yourself and for your own family, right? How are we, it's not to say that somebody who's light and tall and skinny is not beautiful and that we can't continue to tell them that we're beautiful, but are there other messages that you can be offering to young girls who don't look that way, or young boys even, right? Because I think they, even for boys, there's a standard of beauty or handsomeness. So you can start within your own family. Like I said, I think it's important to recognize where do you have influence in your family. Somebody at Ferdowsi says that it can be uncomfortable, but it is necessary to have these conversations. I also shouldn't have expectations that people shouldn't have expectations that people will change, but I can still make approaches to different ways of thinking.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and although we can't expect that people will change, we can certainly leave the door open.
Yes.
Right, that's a very big distinction. Mm-hmm. And as Jillery said, that we are often surprised at how people are willing to take on new ideas, even if they are very challenging.
I'm always surprised by people's humanity. And that's sad to say, but I'm always, you know, I spent 3 years working at the National Council of Canadian Muslims. And my job, we had gotten a big grant to do anti-Islamophobia training in schools across the province. And so I was going to small communities that had one Syrian family. Everybody else was white. They had never seen a person of color, let alone a black hijabi in their life. And these were some of the most ignorant but open communities I had ever been to. It was the metropolitan areas, the Ottawas, the Torontos, that were really stuck in their ways and sometimes more challenging to talk to. But the places that you know, I was often like so nervous being, you know, going into, were the most opening places. So I think it's really important to just try not to have an expectation either way, really. I'm concerned because this is a topic of the hour and that we're focused on discussion. The real test will be how we move forward and continue the conversation and change in our behavior. Absolutely. Yeah. I'm also concerned about this, but I'm hopeful. Like I said, I'm so touched or in awe, like this task force that has come out of the JCC. I don't know what's going to come of it. I'm not really sure of its scope. And I'm sure, you know, there's lots of ways to pick it apart, but to see the education so quickly transform into action is the right direction, in my opinion. And I think that as members of the congregation, it's your responsibility to hold the leadership accountable. Ask, where are we at with that? Where, you know, we're going to be going into a new madrasa year. How are we going to change the way that we teach Black history in dean classes? How are we talking about these things around the table? You know, I do see the Black Lives Matter movement kind of, you know, the something new is going to come and take its place, but in terms of what we're talking about, topic of the day, but you know, I just think we can focus on this community, right? And so I think as members of the congregation, let's focus on this community.
Also, I think it's important to remember that once something comes into our awareness, we can't push it back.
Mm-mm.
You know? Mm-mm. So things that we've been made aware of, and again, the more engaged we are in educating ourselves, listening, learning, unlearning during this time, you know, action is one thing, but you can't really go back and become unconscious of the factors, how the police operate in this world, right? You can't take that back. So, you know, there have been major inroads, and I think there is no going back. Yeah. You know, whether or not we continue to take action is still open for debating. But in terms of our awareness, I think, you know, we we have made actually significant strides in a very short time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yes, I totally agree with that, Marzia. Where we're at today, I mean, how it's just amazing, and there is future. That's the main thing here. Like you had said, normally we address it and then it's kind of forgotten. But I don't see that happening this time. I see the conversations are happening. The interest is there, the need to want to make that change. You know, Jillery, when you had mentioned how you got invited by the group of men.
Yeah.
They're older men. They've had their set thinking, and to get an invite from them, I thought was just...
I know. I was like shocked. And I said, I can't say no. I can't turn it down. I have to make the time to do it because what a gift to be able to sit with elders and talk about these things. I think, you know, it is a gift. So Allah bless George Floyd because, and you know, forgive his shortcomings, because I think that he's opened up conversations for many of our communities.
Yes, I agree. I have one comment here. I'm so thankful that my parents are open-minded and taught us how to treat everyone equal. Mm-hmm. So there again, it starts with the parents, right?
Yeah.
It starts with the nurturing of your child from the time they are able to comprehend to, I even think when they're little, I mean, babies, because they're seeing the interaction, they're picking up little things.
Yeah.
And these are how they are already being molded,
mm-hmm.
right? In ways we don't even realize or think. So definitely starting with parenting is the way to make those changes for sure.
Yeah.
Is there anything else we'd like to add? Anybody else want to have any comments, questions, any takeaways? This has really been a great conversation we've been having.
Hillary, maybe tell people how they can learn more about you, your work.
You can find me at www.inclusiveleaders.ca, my email, or you can contact me through that website as well. I have on the side, I do, it's on the side of my side, I do, I have the Sisters Retreat. It's a retreat for Muslim women that we host in Panama yearly. We were supposed to have one in January, but that's still up in the air. But it really is a beautiful space for Muslim women to have a vacation experience that's catered to us.
That's wonderful. So what's the topic?
It's a wellness retreat. So we do yoga every morning. We rent a villa that has a pool. And then there's also, you know, kind of your local excursions that we do. In Panama, which is my home country. And it's really, you know, it's magical because there are Muslim communities in Panama. There's a mosque in every province, but they're very insular. It's mostly the Indo-Pak and the Arab community that have immigrated there from generations. And so people don't know much about Muslims. And then they see this diverse group of 10 Muslim women deep just walking around Panama City, and everybody has questions, and all the vendors that we work with are so intrigued about, oh, you can travel by yourselves, and where are your husbands, and do you have children? And some of you wear hijab and some of you don't wear hijab. So it's quite a dawah moment. So it's quite lovely.
That sounds exciting.
So yeah. I'll put in my website and the Sisters Retreat as well.
Perfect.
Okay. Social media?
Yes, at the Sisters Retreat is Facebook and Instagram, and my social media is not public, but I'm at Jillery M. And
share that with everybody.
Yeah, please do. I should have
you share that with everybody again?
Yeah, I'm going to try to do that.
So just a quick question from the participants. Have any of you attended or seen our previous drop-in sessions for parents? Or is this your first time?
Yeah, so has anybody been at any of the drop-in programs that Drop and Support Services has held? Or has this been your first time, is what Marzia was asked.
So So I recognize some of the names, but not all of them. So. Yeah.
Perfect. So Julie has put up her contact information, which is great. And is there anything else anybody would like to add from our panelists?
No. Jerry, you are mute.
Thank you for the space and the time. It's been, I've learned a lot, also reflecting on a lot. So thank you for everybody's candor. Yes.
Thank you both for taking your time. I know it's a lot of work, research, and everything that you put into making these webinars happen. Conversation that I've been saying it again has really been amazing. The topics that you covered, really you got into everything that I feel that we could in the time given, and that's really relevant to what families are dealing with as parents, whether you're an elder, you're a parent, you're a child, wherever you are, whatever space you're in the world today. Thank you so much for everything you did. I also like to thank everyone for attending and being a part of it. We had people here who have attended both sessions, which is amazing. And please do share anything that you would like, that you've gotten out of it at events, jss@gmail.com. And whenever you get a moment, just give us a shout and let us know what experiences you're having using the tools that you've received here today. If there's anything else, then I'd like to close the session. And we look forward to our next webinar, wherever it may be and whenever it may be. We definitely will definitely let you know when that's going to happen.
Thank you, ladies. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum salam.